The reason the world rejected Jesus when he was here is the same reason that he is rejected today. People want a Christ who will allow them to do what the real Christ would never condone. That is why in the last days, false Christs will deceive almost the entire world. Do you know what makes their appeal so enticing? Stay tuned, we'll see.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossball. Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. Before we will look at why false doctrines and teachings can be so enticing, let's pray that the Lord will teach us the truth as we read from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank you for a Bible prophecy that tells us what is going to happen in the future and how to get ready for it. And we earnestly pray that as we read now from your holy book, that you will teach us the truth and give us a heart to obey and follow you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's free book is entitled Death in the Kitchen. Just call 1-800-843-8788 and ask for offer BF74. Millions are suffering the side effects of wrong living habits. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer BF74. And now, Pastor John Grossball.
When man first sinned as a result of the devil deceiving Eve. Remember, Eve said that she was deceived by the serpent. And who was that serpent that deceived her? Who was it that appeared like a serpent and deceived her? The Bible tells us very plainly who it was. In Revelation, the 12th chapter, it says that there was war in heaven. This was just before our world was created. It says, war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought. But they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Notice, the devil is an angel. He's a leading angel. He has angels under his command. He was cast out of this world. He was a cherub who covers. You can read that in Ezekiel 28. We read that in a previous program. The devil was a leading angel in heaven. He was a cherub. He was created perfect. He was perfect in all his ways. Until the Bible says his heart became lifted up, he became proud as a result of his beauty. Isaiah talks about this being in Isaiah the 14th chapter and how pride led to his fall. He wrote, "How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit." The Bible says that pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. In fact, the Bible says that the time is coming when all the proud will burn up. You can read that in Malachi, the 4th chapter. Jesus said, "The meek will inherit the earth." It may not seem that way now, but that's what Jesus predicts is going to happen in the future. When man sinned, the Lord pronounced a curse on the devil. In Genesis, the 3rd chapter, it says, "The Lord God said to the serpent, 'Because you have done this, you are cursed. You are cursed.'" And then he addressed directly Satan himself in verse 15. And he said, "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. This prophecy predicted that there would be enmity between Satan and the human race. And this enmity has been strikingly displayed down through the ages. We read in a previous program about the devil's hatred of Job because Job was faithful to God. And the devil said to the Lord, if you take away his wealth, or if you take away his health, he will curse you. The Lord said, okay, you're not going to be able to destroy his life, though. And you can read that story in the book of Job. Job lost everything. And then he got boils from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet, and he was in pain, and everybody was mocking him. You can read the awful story in the book of Job, showing, this was, by the way, clear back in the early ages of the world, before Moses' time, when Job lived, showing that calamity, suffering, pain is caused by evil spirits. In our world, God gets blamed constantly for things that he doesn't do, that evil spirits are doing. Satan summons all of his forces and throws his whole power into the combat. And why doesn't he meet with greater resistance from Christians? Why are the soldiers of Christ so sleepy and so indifferent? Well, is it because they do not really have a close connection with their Lord and Savior, because they are destitute of His Spirit? Does sin not seem repulsive and abhorrent to Christians today, as it was to their Master? Do Christians today not meet sin as Christ did, with decisive and determined resistance? Do Christians not realize the exceeding evil and malignity of sin? Are they blinded to both its character and the power of the prince of darkness? One of the reasons that there is so little enmity between Christians today and Satan is that people have forgotten what the Bible says about his character. Multitudes of people today are deluded on this subject. They do not seem to understand that their enemy is a mighty, powerful, and wise general who controls the minds of evil angels, and that he has well-matured plans and skillful movements which he uses to war against Christ and to prevent the salvation of souls. Among professed Christians today, often there is scarcely a reference to Satan, even from ministers, except perhaps an incidental mention in the pulpit. People overlook the evidence of his continual activity and success, and they neglect the many warnings in the Bible of his subtlety. In fact, some people seem to ignore his very existence. And while men are ignorant of what is going on, this vigilant foe is upon their track every moment. The devil intrudes his presence into every department of the household, in every street in our cities, in the churches, in the national councils, in the courts of justice, perplexing and deceiving, seducing everywhere, ruining the souls and the bodies of men, women, and children, breaking up families, sowing hatred and emulation and strife, sedition and murder. And here it is, the Christian world act as though these things were appointed by God and that they had to exist. The fact of the matter is, today, the reason we see so much evil in our world is because of the active agency of evil spirits who influence evil men to work their will. Satan is seeking all the time to overcome the people of God by breaking down the barriers that separate them from the world. When you read your Bible, you find in the Old Testament that ancient Israel was enticed into sin when they ventured into forbidden social associations with the heathen. In a similar manner, Christians today are led astray. Notice what the Apostle Paul says about this in 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. He says, "We have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. For even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them." Their minds are blinded. How do their minds get blinded? Notice what the Apostle Paul says in this very same book, 2 Corinthians 11, verses 13 to 15. He says, "For such are false apostles." There were false teachers in those days, just like today. "Deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works." The Bible teaches from beginning to end, in the judgment, you're going to be judged according to your works. Your profession is not going to count. There will be millions of people who profess to be Christians and live like the devil, who will find themselves lost in the day of final judgment, because the judgment is according to works. Notice, it's not your profession that will save you. It's not a profession of Christianity that will save you. Are you living the Christian life? Well, if you are a decided follower of Christ, you will know that temptations exist. The devil will send to you temptations. When Christians choose the society of the ungodly and unbelieving, they expose themselves to temptation. Well, conformity to the world converts the church to the world. It never converts the world to the church. Familiarity with sin will inevitably cause it to appear less repulsive. He who chooses to associate with the servants of Satan will soon cease to fear their master. Well, those who are often least suspected of being so are often used as servants of Satan to deceive others. People who are highly educated, people who are very talented, can be used by the arch deceiver more successfully than others to lead other people into the way of sin and lawlessness. This is what happened to the highly educated people in Christ's day. When Jesus talked to them in John the 8th chapter, this is what he said to them. They said to Jesus, they said, "God is our Father. We haven't been born of fornication." Jesus said to them, "Well, if God was your Father, you would love me, because I proceeded and came forth from God. Neither did I come for myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Why cannot receive what I say?" Because, here's what Jesus said, "Why do you not understand my speech? Because you are not able to listen to my word. You are of your father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own, for he is a liar and the father of it." How does the rest of the universe, not this world, how does the rest of the universe decide when they look at people in this world who's on God's side of the great controversy and who's on the devil's side? Stay tuned. We'll see.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own without any help or guideline to follow can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. When Jesus was here, remember the religious leaders of his day said to him, "We are God's children. God is our Father." And the people who claimed that God was their Father crucified this Jesus Christ. Jesus said to them, "If God were your Father, you would love me, because I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither did I come from myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Why can you not receive my word? Because you are of your father the devil." John 8:44, "You are of your father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning." Notice, the devil was a murderer, and those people were plotting to murder Christ right then. So Jesus said they were of the devil. And then it says he was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And then Jesus said to them, he said, "Because I tell you the truth, you don't believe me. You won't receive me. You won't believe me because I'm telling you the truth." And then he said, "He who is of God hears God's words. Therefore, you do not hear because you are not of God." He challenged them. In verse 46, he said, "Which of you convicts me of sin?" They had nothing to say. You see, Jesus said that the way that it was determined whether God was your father or the devil was your father was by your character. If you had a character like the devil, he was a murderer and a liar, then he was your spiritual father, even though you claimed that God was your father. And the Apostle John makes it very clear that this is how the whole rest of the universe, the loyal universe, decides, how they decide when they look at our world, which people are the children of God and which people are the children of the devil. The Apostle John made this exceedingly clear and plain in 1 John 3, verse 8. This is what he wrote. "He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." Notice, the person who is living in sin is a child of the devil. When a person is converted, then the life of sin is stopped and they start living a different life, a righteous life, a holy life. What is sin? 1 John 3:4 says, "Sin is lawlessness." The person that is living in sin is living a life that is not in harmony with God's law. He's violating it. He's breaking it and trying to get others to violate it and break it. And people think that you can break God's law your whole life, just keep your sins confessed, and you can break God's law your whole life and then go to heaven. But friend, the New Testament doesn't teach that. Jesus didn't teach that. Notice what Jesus said was going to happen in the final judgment. In Matthew, the 7th chapter, this is the Sermon on the Mount. This is what Jesus said is going to happen in the day of final judgment. He said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven." The people that call Jesus Lord are the people that claim to be Christians. He's not talking about people who are not Christians, people who are non-believers, people who belong to a non-Christian religion. He's not talking about them. He's talking here about Christians, the people that call him Lord. Notice what he said is going to happen. He said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Notice what the problem is? They claim to be Christians, but they're living in violation of God's law. They're practicing lawlessness. The devil is their real father, even though they claim that God is their father. They claim that they're Christians, but they are not acknowledged by the unfallen universe as being followers of Jesus Christ. The devil is constantly trying to deceive people on this point. Get people to think that you can live in sin and yet go to heaven. That's not what Jesus taught. That's not what the apostles taught. Satan is constantly trying to deceive people, deceive their minds. And people need to remember that there is a battle going on. And this is not a battle with other human beings, not a battle with other people. Notice how the Apostle Paul talked about it in Ephesians, the 6th chapter. He said, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. The Apostle Paul said, our warfare is not with flesh and blood. It's against spiritual power, spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. Here's the way the Apostle Peter put it. In 1 Peter 5 and verse 8, he said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Well, from the days of Adam down to our own time, our great enemy, the devil, has been exercising his power to oppress and to destroy the human race. And he is now preparing for his last campaign against the church. In preparation for this campaign, he has persuaded millions of Christians that it doesn't matter if you sin as long as you keep your sins confessed. The Bible teaches that sin is something that a Christian is to overcome. Satan is now preparing for his last campaign against the church, and everyone who seeks to follow Jesus will be brought into conflict with this relentless foe. The more nearly a Christian imitates the divine pattern, the more surely will he make himself a mark for the attacks of Satan. All who are actively engaged in the cause of God, seeking to unveil the deceptions of the evil one and to present Christ before the people, will be able to say with the Apostle Paul that he serves the Lord with all humility of mind and many tears and temptations. Satan met Christ with his fiercest temptations and the most subtle also, but he was always repulsed. Those battles were fought in your behalf and my behalf so that we also can conquer. Christ will give you strength if you seek it. No man without his own consent can be overcome by Satan. The tempter does not have the power to control your will or to force you to sin. He can distress, but not contaminate. He can cause agony, but not defilement. Christ has conquered, and that should inspire his followers also to fight manfully the battles of the Lord. But Jesus said that in the last days, that times would become so deceptive by false Christ that if possible, even the elect would be deceived. This is what Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 24. Jesus said, false Christs and false prophets will arise and show great signs and wonders, so as to deceive, if possible, even the elect. Friend, how is it going to be with you? As we draw near the end of this earth's history, the Bible declares that these evil spirits will deceive the whole world. The only people that will not be deceived are the people that check the Bible, know what the Bible says about the issue. Notice what it says in Revelation 16 is going to happen. Revelation 16, verses 13 and 14. It says, I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are spirits of demons, performing signs which go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. The Bible declares that evil spirits are going to gather the whole world together for the battle of that great day of God Almighty. We just read it in Revelation 16, 13, and 14. The Apostle Paul said, we are not ignorant of his devices. Here's the way the Apostle Paul said it in 2 Timothy 2. He said, that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. We're living in the time when the Apostle Paul said that evil spirits would sear the consciences of men so that they would teach false doctrines. And one of the most serious and dangerous of these false doctrines is the idea that you can just go on and live a life of sin and yet go to heaven. Just keep your sins confessed. Friend, Jesus wants to give you the Holy Spirit to enable you to overcome sin so that you can be His child indeed and not just by profession. Do you want to have a real Christian experience that will last in the day of judgment? The choice is up to you.
We pray that today's sermon will be a blessing to you. We want to send you a free copy of today's book, Death in the Kitchen. To get your very own copy, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788 and ask for offer BF74. Did you realize that the Bible talks about health and eating? Millions are suffering the side effects of wrong living habits and harmful eating and drinking. What is in the kitchen that may be killing you or your loved ones? The cries of the sick and diseased are the trademarks of modern society. The Bible gives a simple, concise answer to the question of premature, disability, and death. Find out what that answer is. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH to get Death in the Kitchen and ask for offer BF74. From all of us here at Steps to Life, may God bless you as you seek to learn more and more of His truths.
Thank you for joining us for today's program. Locally and worldwide, people are blessed by our offers of free Bible studies and free booklets because of your support. Our ministry is funded by God's children. If the Holy Spirit impresses you to send a gift to Steps to Life, you can send to Steps to Life, Post Office Box 782828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. Or you can donate by calling our 800 number, 1-800-THE-TRUTH, or visiting our website.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. Steps to Life is supported by your donations. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org. And our web address is www.stepstolife.org.